Now I want to discuss the nerves of another one of our nerve plexus plaques. This plexus plaque is a little more simplified in, it doesn't compare nerves to muscles, but it can be a little more difficult. We have to imagine the layout that we're talking about. But again, we can see the spinal cord and the various nerves arising from that spinal cord. So I want to start at the top and work our way down. Again, in the cervical region of the spinal cord, we're going to have the cervical plexus, nerves of the cervical plexus. And on this plaque, about the only nerves we can tell for sure, there's a little loop of a nerve right here. This is supposed to represent the portion of the cervical plexus called the ansa, or the ansa cervicalis. The ansa is a loop of nerve tissue, nerve fibers within the neck that sends off branches to some of the varying muscles. Those branches are not depicted here. We can also see coming from C3, 4, and 5, they've cut it off right here. This was the phrenic nerve, which we know should be anterior to the anterior scalene muscle, but not depicted on this model. Now we are down to the nerves of the brachial plexus. Remember, the brachial plexus comes from C5, 6, 7, 8, and T1. And we have nerves leaving C5, 6, 7, 8, T1, which will be divided into the roots of the plexus, the trunks of the plexus, the divisions of the plexus, and the cords of the plexus. And we can kind of make out the roots and the trunks, but I'm not going to worry about those on this model. What I want to do is follow them out and see if we can find some of the nerves that we know should go to the upper extremity. The brachial plexus, where we get into the anterior divisions, forms a structure that looks a little bit like an M, and here I can see part of my M. The lateral portion of the M here is the musculocutaneous nerve. That supplies muscles in the anterior compartment of the arm and skin in the lateral forearm, the musculocutaneous nerve. The middle part of our M shape is the median nerve. The median nerve does nothing in the arm, but passes into the anterior forearm, where it innervates the majority of muscles in the anterior forearm. It does all but 1.5 of the muscles in this anterior forearm, and then passes into the hand to innervate 4.5 muscles in the hand. The last part of our M is this nerve here, which is the ulnar nerve. Notice the ulnar nerve passes through the arm, innervating nothing, but it passes posterior to the medial epicondyle of the humerus. Many of you have probably bumped your elbow and hit what you call the funny bone. The funny bone is actually the ulnar nerve. So when you bump your funny bone, you are crushing your ulnar nerve between whatever you bumped your arm against and that humerus. The ulnar nerve passes then behind the medial epicondyle of the humerus and into the medial aspect of the forearm, where it will innervate 1.5 muscles in the forearm, and then it will pass into the hand, where it innervates all but 4.5 muscles in the hand. Now we also have, coming from the brachial plexus, the axillary nerve and the radial nerve. The axillary nerve passes right behind the surgical neck of the humerus to innervate the deltoideus muscle and the teres minor muscle. So we can see here a nerve here passing behind the bone and wrapping around. This is our axillary nerve. The other nerve is the radial nerve, and on this model we kind of lose it. It's passing through here and it goes behind the humerus in what is called the radial groove or the spiral groove, and then emerges on the lateral side of the arm and forearm. The radial nerve innervates all of the muscles in the posterior arm and the forearm and the overlying skin. Now we can see roughly the same thing on the other side of this plexus plaque. However, here they have taken that forearm from supination into pronation, so we lose a little bit of the relationship. Again, wrapping around the head of the humerus, or the surgical neck of the humerus, the axillary nerve to the deltoideus and the teres minor. We can see the musculocutaneous nerve passing anterior to the humerus. We can see the median nerve coming down into the forearm. Then it gets a little confusing here because they've pronated the forearm. We can see the ulnar nerve going behind the medial epicondyle of the humerus. Then again, we kind of lose it here. because of the pronation of the forearm, and we can see the radial nerve passing behind the humerus here in the radial or spiral groove, and then traveling along, and should be the lateral aspect of the forearm. And this is now the lateral aspect of the forearm, anatomically speaking, but we have pronated that forearm, so we have brought lateral over to medial, the radial nerve. So those are the nerves of the brachial plexus that we can see on this plexus plaque. Working our way down, we go into the thoracic region. On this plexus plaque, they do not depict anything associated with the sympathetic nervous system. So all we can see on this plexus plaque, thoracic-wise, is at every vertebral level we have an intercostal nerve traveling underneath the ribs. The 12th nerve from the thoracic region cannot be called an intercostal nerve because intercostal means between ribs and there isn't a 13th rib. So the 12th nerve from the thoracic region is known as the subcostal nerve. So all of these were intercostal nerves. T12 is the subcostal nerve. Then we enter into the lumbar plexus. The lumbar plexus is found within the muscle fibers of the psoas major muscle. However, that has been removed on this model. We can see from L1, we have the iliohypogastric and the ilioinguinal nerves. Then we can see traveling across toward the lateral side of the femur, the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve. Then we can see coming anterior to the pelvis and to the front of the thigh, the femoral nerve. And also we can see the obturator nerve passing down through the pelvis. And on this model, it's kind of hard to depict, but it comes out because obturator nerve will supply the muscles in the medial aspect of the thigh or the adductor compartment of the thigh. On the opposite side of this model, they have laterally rotated the entire lower extremity. So we're looking at a medial view of this lower extremity. So again, I can see the subcostal nerve, the iliohypogastric nerve, the ilioinguinal nerve, the lateral femoral cutaneous nerve. This nerve now is the obturator nerve. The obturator nerve passing to the medial side of the thigh. Remember, we have laterally rotated this leg or lower extremity so that we are looking at the medial compartment of the thigh. So here is our obturator nerve. Those are nerves of the lumbar plexus. Now, immediately below that, we will enter the sacral plexus. Some books go as far as to say the lumbosacral plexus because they basically feed into each other. The only real nerve we can see of the sacral plexus on this model is this very large nerve called the sciatic nerve. The sciatic nerve passes out of the posterior pelvis and into the posterior thigh. So on this side, we see the sciatic nerve, and it's going to disappear on us because it's going behind the femur. On this laterally rotated lower extremity, we can now see that posterior femoral region. So we have the sciatic nerve, the largest nerve in the body. The sciatic nerve is really the common peroneal nerve, sometimes referred to as the common fibular nerve, and the tibial nerve, wrapped in the same common nerve sheath. So here we can see sciatic nerve coming down, and right here near the knee, we see it divides out into the common peroneal nerve and the tibial nerve. The common peroneal nerve goes out by the head of the fibula. Because we have laterally rotated this lower extremity, we can't see the fibula. It's hidden behind the tibia here. But if we hop over to the other leg, we can see the head of the fibula because we didn't laterally rotate this lower extremity. So imagine passing behind the femur here, the sciatic nerve, and right about here dividing into common peroneal and tibial. The tibial will continue straight down posterior in the leg. We cannot see it on this side. The common peroneal will wrap around the head of the fibula. So we see it right here, where it is actually quite exposed. A blow to the lateral part of the fibula right here could damage that common peroneal nerve. That common peroneal nerve right there at the head of the fibula will divide into what is called the deep peroneal nerve and the superficial peroneal nerve. The deep peroneal nerve travels in the anterior compartment of the leg, the anterior compartment of the leg, and out onto the dorsum of the foot, whereas the superficial peroneal nerve stays along the fibula to take care of the lateral compartment of the leg. Now, if we go back over to this laterally rotated lower extremity, the common peroneal nerve we know wrapped around the head of the fibula, and we don't get to see the superficial peroneal nerve anymore because it's out by the fibula, but we can see running in the anterior compartment of the leg and out onto the dorsum of the foot, the deep peroneal nerve. The other portion was the tibial nerve. Remember, sciatic nerve branched into common peroneal nerve and the tibial nerve. The tibial nerve will continue down into the posterior compartment of the leg, where it innervates all of the muscles in the posterior compartment of the leg. They will pass behind the medial malleolus of the ankle, where it goes onto the bottom of the foot. And when it reaches the bottom of the foot, it divides to form the medial and the lateral plantar nerve. Well, because we have rotated this lower extremity, we are looking at the medial side of this foot. So here was our tibial nerve coming down behind the medial malleolus and dividing, and here we can see the medial plantar nerve. The lateral plantar nerve has gone to the lateral side of the foot, which is turned away from us in this model. So it does a pretty good depiction of covering most of the nerves that we would need to know in the extremities.